Hello, everybody. Luke back once again. I know we missed a week here for the podcast. The Breakdown Podcast is back with Luke, and we're going to be breaking down some of the biggest stories that's happened in tech and just in the world in general, and talking about what I find interesting. If you enjoy this, do me a big favor. Hit that subscribe button, hit that thumbs up. If you're watching this on YouTube, I do have an MP3 version available over on many different podcasts and platforms, including Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and so much more. I'll put a link to that all down below. But we're going to be chatting. If you have a story you want me to talk about, you have a question, a topic you want me to discuss, or anything really, feel free to email me, thebreakdownwithluke@gmail.com. Again, that's over at thebreakdownwithluke@gmail.com. All right, let's start off with maybe a little bit of tech history here. We'll see how important this was. But Google Plus is now 10 years old. They launched on June 28th, back just 10 years ago. Two things jumped out here. First of all, it felt like Google Plus was a lot older than 10 years. Anybody with me? And it made me think of some other tech services, other social media networks in particular, that kind of were huge and then just kind of fell apart. One of them I was thinking about was Foursquare. Foursquare kind of really made the whole checking in, letting people know where you are thing really popular. Now everybody does that, right? I can tag myself on tweets and on YouTube or videos and in posts on Facebook, just to name a few. Because of all that and all the check-in and different features under other apps, Foursquare has gone away. I think Foursquare is a random victim of something that's pretty simple. Foursquare was a very simple idea that was very easy to copy. Because of that, because it was so easy to copy, other people copied it. And with that, hey, why do I need to download Foursquare if I can check in on Facebook or other services and more and let people know where I am and what I'm doing? Kind of a interesting fact. I mean, that's the problem with most things. I've had this in my entire life. Whenever I get a good business idea, doesn't matter if I was selling at the flea market in college, how I helped pay my way through college, or I was running a news site and more. When you have a good idea, people will try to copy it instantly and sometimes very shamelessly. As you could probably have seen, you probably know many people copy things without remorse or without credit. Is what it is. But keep that in mind. If you ever want to launch a business or more like Foursquare, always remember somebody's going to be trying to copy you. Somebody's going to be trying to take advantage of what you did. And if you're not careful, they'll just take all your business from you. It's kind of the reality of business, unfortunately. So keep that in mind. But let me know, what are some other tech things or social media networks you've used? Definitely remember Dig. That was a big one. Still around. Actually, when I would get news stories on Dig, a surprising amount of traffic would come from it, honestly. But I also remember MySpace. That was my first big social media network. AOL Messenger, Yahoo Messenger. Kind of have to admit, a little bit of social networking there. You get your friends list. You're able to have profiles a little bit there. So definitely kind of remember those back in the day. I don't know, let me know. It still surprises me to this day that Yahoo Messenger and AOL Messenger, to name a few, were unable to compete. You look at the Slacks and you look at Discord and so many others, and you think, how come, you know, Yahoo Messenger and AOL Messenger weren't able to kind of create this environment? Pretty much the exact same thing, with a cool few new features added. It definitely kind of shows you, you know, what is hot now may not always be hot forever. Just because Facebook seems unstoppable now, hey, Facebook, just warning you, you can be replaced. There are many things in our history that have shown, hey, this was the hot thing and now it's not. All right, let's move on. We talked about ADT suing Ring over their signs. The argument was that the Ring sign, that stop sign looking little blue sign in both of them, was too close to their trademark or their business dress, a lot of people call it. And now Amazon has agreed to change their siren sign, that little sign that sits outside your home and lets people know that you have a security system that will look different. Now, I was a little skeptical about this, but apparently Amazon has decided this was not worth fighting. Ring's big complaint was they were basically the same kind of thing. They were both the same shape and they were both blue, even though it was a slightly different shade of blue. But that was a big complaint on Ring's or ADT's part against Amazon's Ring. And Amazon has said, okay, rather than fighting this, though I do think Amazon could have probably won this. We'll see. But you have to now wait for them to get a new one. So if you currently try to go to Ring's page to buy one of those outdoor signs, you're going to get a 404 error page, except in the UK where it's still being sold. And Amazon has promised to come up with a redesigned looking sign. And we'll see how that plays out. But let me know. Did you find the Ring and ADT signs confusing at all? I did not, but I do understand if you don't protect your trademark, your trade dress, whatever, you lose it. And this was a big thing for me and people, the fact that, hey, you know, we really don't want to sue this company, but they are infringing on our trademark or whatever. And if we don't sue them or don't ask them to stop, we will lose our trademark. And that's how a trademark works. If you want to have it, you must defend it under U.S. law. So keep that in mind when these kind of things come up. If you have Microsoft Windows, please go update. There is a zero-day vulnerability that was discovered in Windows Printer Spool service that can allow remote access and remote threats into your system. Microsoft has rolled out their normal monthly update, but they have a July 6th important update out there. Go out there. Do a quick update. It takes a few seconds. It will auto-update if you have auto-update set up. But this will help protect your computer. Hey, Mac owners, Apple fans, I see you smirking over there. Apple's had quite a few zero-day vulnerabilities they've tried to roll out recently. It's not just Microsoft, so keep that in mind, folks. And regardless what you have, Android, iPhone, Macs, PC, hackers are out there. Now, a big thing for Apple for a long time, I thought this was kind of a dumb argument. Oh, look, you know, hardly any viruses, any hacks targeting Apple. Well, Apple was so small, of course, hackers didn't bother with them. Why go after less than 10% of the market at the time when you could go after 90% of the market? Well, now that Apple's getting bigger, and really they've kind of trained their users not to be skeptical of different technology or different particular security vulnerabilities, customers are now becoming very vulnerable to malware of all kinds because they're so used to the idea that, hey, there aren't any on our platform. Well, guess what? Now there is. And unlike Windows customers who are taking a constant vigil of, hey, I gotta be careful what I install, did I get this program from a reliable source and more, Apple customers aren't quite as diligent on that. So we'll have to keep an eye on it. Hey, follow up from a previous podcast. Next story up. There is a new ransomware attack and hackers are demanding $70 million to end the world's biggest ransomware attack and one that's being described as maybe one of the most sophisticated ransomware attacks ever, not only in the way it's done, but when it was done, deliberately targeting the 4th of July holiday in the United States so that many companies would not have full staff and may not notice in time to prevent the ransomware from spreading through their network. It wasn't the first time we've seen massive attacks like this. Just this year, we had a massive oil pipeline shut down, plus the world's largest producer of meat was hit by ransomware and had to stop operations at many facilities. Now this one targeted a zero-day vulnerability, which is basically an undiscovered before vulnerability that allowed them to come in and hack into many computers using several different systems. The cybersecurity firm estimates at least 17 countries, including the United States, South Africa, United Kingdom, Canada, Argentina, Mexico, Indonesia, New Zealand, and so many more have been affected by this. Now, they're demanding $70 million, for a program that will unlock these computers. Now, I've talked about this before, but I really think it's time for our federal government to take these ransomware attacks seriously. Not just as anything, but random like civil or domestic kind of issues, but as a national security issue. And once again, we're seeing foreign players coming in and attacking key infrastructure within the United States, our food supply, our energy supply, and now a whole host of different parts of our economy have been attacked in basically a criminal act. And it needs to be not just treated as a criminal act, but as a national security act. Much as we've viewed attacks like physical attacks in the past, I don't think a cyber attack like this is any different than a physical attack on a pipeline would be, for example. And I do believe, though, that our weak response on the federal government level to the earlier attacks for both the meat plants and for the oil pipelines have invited other attacks here really do hope, we'll see what happens, but I do hope that we can see our federal government step up and take these more seriously in a more aggressive and public way, because you kind of have to make an example of this. We'll have to see what happens. Fingers crossed that this gets addressed, but until you scare people, they're going to keep doing this, because if I can get millions from this and it's, you know, low risk, it's not like I have to worry about anybody coming and prosecuting me because I don't live there, they're going to keep doing it. So we have to do more to stop this. We'll wait and see what happens with it. Hey, a little interlude here. If you are down south in Florida, everything, the hurricane, as I'm recording this, is striking Florida, moving up through Georgia and other parts of the south. Hey, my thoughts go out to you. I hope you are being safe. Please, I know it's not a massive hurricane. I've been in several of these smaller ones myself. Please be careful. Please don't assume, oh, I'll be fine just because it's a small storm. People still die from these. Please be careful and listen to local authorities on it. All right, let's move on. Nintendo Switch OLED is coming out. Yes, a new Nintendo Switch model is coming out, but not the Nintendo Pro. Though several reports have come out that they still believe the Nintendo Pro is being worked on, that this is more of a minor upgrade as Nintendo waits for upgraded or computer chips out there to address the fact that there's a massive computer chip shortage. Now, these new Nintendo Switch OLED monitors have bigger screens on it, a little bit better power underneath the hood. And one of the big improvements is the fact that it does allow the Ethernet to be plugged in. Now, it did say better power. That may be a little confusing. It's better graphics. It does have the same RAM and the same processing, I believe, on it. So we'll have to keep an eye on it. Now, this was rumored to happen around E3. According to many reports, Nintendo is struggling, like many people, to get the necessary chips. Chips are still in very short supply, and they're struggling to get their hands on them. Now, that has caused Nintendo and others to push back the release of many products, and many are speculating that the Nintendo Switch OLED is an attempt to recoup some investment costs into the Nintendo Switch Pro, but they're unable to get the chips and materials they need to manufacture it right now and get it shipped over to the United States. Not only are game companies struggling to get the chips they need, they're struggling to get cargo space on transports from Asia to the United States and other places. Cargo shipping is really bottlenecked right now. As many factories are coming back online, we're seeing a massive demand for cargo shipping. That has resulted in a huge number of people out there unable to get their shipments when they want them or severely delayed. I ordered a cabinet for my new home in October last year. We still don't have it. In July, have some family members ordered patio furniture in January of this year, and they still don't have it. Getting shipments of such items are very difficult right now. We'll have to keep an eye on this, but I still say, or at least people, and I agree, people who are out there who have early reported the Nintendo Pro rumors of a 4K Nintendo Pro Switch, still say they believe that that's in the works, so that for whatever reason, probably because Nintendo was unable to get the chips and the shipping they want, we're going to have to wait a little bit longer and see how it works out. I don't know. Let me know. Are you a Nintendo Switch fan? I am. I've been replaying some Mario Sunshine. I got the 3D anniversary kits, and I recently started playing that. Problem is, you know, being a parent, you got to get the Switch away from your kids. So keep that in mind. All right. Now, this one is interesting. There's a new calculator that claims to predict how long seniors have to live, and they say they can be accurate to within 6 months. And the calculator will also help you piece together different things you can do to affect how your lifespan is, eating better, exercising, and more with that. Now, this raises a lot of questions. A, how accurate really are they? B, would you really want to know when you're going to die? Now, you probably want to know, hey, you know, if I take better vitamins, if I do this, if I do that, maybe I can prolong my life. But how would you like it to know if somebody came out and said, hey, Luke, you have 18 months, give or take 6 months. Would you want that? Would you actually want to know that? Or would you rather live in ignorant bliss? I don't know. That's a tough question. I really want to hear from you on that. Ignorant bliss is ignorant bliss. You know, you're going out, you're enjoying life. Once you know that there's death right in front of you, it definitely can change how you live your life. And would you want that? Would you go do stuff you didn't do? Would you continue your life as normal? I don't know. That's kind of interesting. It's called the Respect Calculator. It allows their families and their loved ones to plan. For example, it can help an adult or child plan when to take leave of absence from work, to be with a parent, or decide when to take the last family vacation together, for example. I don't know. That just seems weird to me. But it's definitely, for some people, it's something they really want to know. Are you one of them? Leave me a comment. Let me know. Hey, do you live in Wisconsin? Do you live in Plover, Wisconsin? P-L-O-V-E-R, Wisconsin. Hey, check out your water tower. They just finished repainting it, and people have noticed they misspelled the city name on it. The village of Plover, I guess I say Plover, is misspelled with flipping the V and the O around on the water tower the wrong way. As always, double check your spelling, especially if you're doing something as big as that tower. I'm sure the city contracted this work out is probably less than happy, and they are already working to fix the giant typo on it out there. But yep, if you live there, look around. Have you ever noticed a typo? Disney is notorious every now and then for having typos on different things. Leave me a comment. Let me know. Have you ever noticed a really bad typo on a big permanent structure? It's one thing to have a typo on a website, you know, especially when you're doing breaking news, you're rushing the story, right? You're trying to concentrate on getting the facts right in the story. Yeah, typos are going to happen. They happen all the time. I think it's a little different when you have to do three words and you're painting the city name on a water tower and you misspell the city's name. Leave me a comment. Let me know if you've ever noticed anything like that before. I'd love to hear from you. Hey, one note, if you haven't checked out my new YouTube channel, the video game channel is going gangbusters over there. Thank you to everybody. It is growing very quickly with a lot of traffic. Really do appreciate it. Check it out. Luke BK on YouTube. Luke BK on YouTube. You can find the link there. It is a great place to find out all things about video games, news, rumors, reviews, and new games are coming out. So check that out. Really would love your support of that. We really do appreciate it. All right, has your habits changed? Now, this is something I've been talking with some family about over the 4th of July. You know, how have we changed after 2020? One thing I did notice is a lot of people are rushing to get back to normal. The 4th of July, at least around where I lived, was, I think, even busier than normal. More people traveling than normal. More fireworks, it seemed like, than normal. As it seems like people are desperate to get back to more of normal, to be honest with you. I'd love to hear from you. Have you noticed that, hey, travel seems to be getting back to normal? People seem to be actually interacting more with each other and going out and doing vacations. Hotels are hard to get. Rental cars are hard to get. Now, rental cars are hard to get a little bit because to help keep rental car companies afloat, many rental company cars sold rental vehicles that were excess last year when no one was renting vehicles. But also, there's a very high demand of them. Leave me a comment. Let me know what is that like where you live. Are you rushing to get back to normal? I really want to hear from you. I know for me, I definitely am ready to get back to normal. You know, I feel safe. I feel comfortable. But what about you? What about where you live? I have noticed all different parts of the world, different reactions. It's very interesting to see how different people are reacting differently. But, you know, where it was, you know, after the mask mandates were lifted where I live here in Michigan, I would say about 60% of people were still wearing them. Fast forward a few weeks, only about maybe 10% at most when I go into the grocery stores are still wearing them. Is that similar to where you live? It definitely feels like people are trying desperately to get back to normal. I'd love to hear from you. Well, everybody, that's it for the podcast this week. I hope you enjoyed this. Leave me a comment. Let me know what you think of these shows. I would appreciate the feedback. Otherwise, check back for more videos coming out real soon. I hope everybody's being safe. Take care. Enjoy the beautiful summer. I hope it's great wherever you live. Thanks, everybody. And as always, don't forget to hit subscribe and hit that thumbs up if you're new here. We really appreciate it.